think we can have any of this young age? I don't think so. Let's bow our heads in a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Father, we come to give you the honor and the glory this morning in Jesus' name, Father. Father in heaven, we thank you this morning for saved, sanctified, and filling us with the Holy Spirit and redeeming us from the curse of the law. In Jesus' name, Father. Father, we thank you for your resurrection this morning, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for what you're doing in each and every one of our lives, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Father, we thank you this morning, Father, for blessing Liberty United Worship Center in Jesus' name, Father. Continue to watch over and guide them and bless them and keep them from all hurt, harm, and danger in Jesus' name, Father. Father, we ask you to bless the musicians this morning, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Oh, Father, we ask you to bless the praise team, Father, and most of all, bless the word that come forth this morning in Jesus' name that we apply to our life, Father. In Jesus' name, we're giving you the honor and the glory this morning, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Father, we ask you to bless the absent and part of the church this morning, Father. Father, for them that's on their way, bless them, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Oh, Father, any that are sick this morning, Father, we ask you to heal them, Father, right now, Father. Based on your word, Father, by your stripes they healed, in Jesus' name, Father. Your word goes out and it cannot come back void. Father, in Jesus' name, we're giving you the honor and the glory for this service this morning, Father. Father, we ask you to continue to bless the shepherd of this house, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Continue to keep him on a straight and narrow path, Father. Watch over his family, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Bless his wife, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Let the word flow from his mouth, Father, into our heart today, in Jesus' name, Father. Father, we ask you to bless the neighborhood, Father. Oh, Father, and ask them, Lord, don't want to be saved, Father. What must I do to be saved in Jesus' name, Father? We thank you this morning, Father, for our guests this morning, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Continue to bless them, Father, in Jesus' name, Father. Oh, Father, we thank you, Father, for each and everything that you're doing in our life, Father. We give you the honor and the glory right now. In Jesus' name, let the church say amen. We're going to have, hallelujah, we're going to have our reading by Brother Rick.
Good morning. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. I'd like to say good morning to y'all. And today's a special day for me. And celebrating my daughter's 16th birthday today. And I want her to know at 16, you better get right. I got to put this belt on you. Today's scripture comes from Philippians chapter 2, 1 through 11. If you have it in your Bible, please turn. Or if you have today's program that's on the back, please read with me. All hearts and minds are clear. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also had highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And today's church announcement by Mother Johnson.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Our announcement are as follower. Don't forget our upcoming breakfast on April the 16th at 9 o'clock a.m. Please try to sell your ticket. Try to invite people to come out and enjoy us on that day. We have a invited to a revival from Pastor Lee, Restoration Life Empowerment Center, on April the 14th and 15th at 7:30 p.m. Our church order service is on Tuesday night. We have Bible 30 at 7:30. Wednesday is our fast day. Thursday night we have spiritual growth night, roundtable discussion. Saturday morning we have 8 o'clock prayer. And on Sunday, our Sunday school starts at 9:30 and our service begins at 11 o'clock a.m. Those are the announcements at this time.
Praise the Lord, everybody. We're going to prepare to start our morning devotions. Amen. I thank the Lord for another day. I thank him for my life this morning. Amen. I just thank God for who he is. I just thank him just for being God all by himself. Amen. I thank God for this Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Because without the resurrection, there will be no need for any of us to be here. Amen. So we're going to go ahead and start our devotions at this time. I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me, we're all a part of God's body. It is his will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. Come on, if you know, sing with me. I need you.
I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is his will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
Come on, one more time. I need you. Hallelujah.
I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is his will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I pray You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. I love you. I need you to survive. I love you. I need you to survive.
Hallelujah.
I love you. I need you to survive.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I love you. I need you to survive. Amen. Hallelujah. I pray for you. You pray for me. Hallelujah. I love you. I need you to survive. Amen. Hallelujah. We need each other. Amen. Hallelujah. Sometimes you could be so burdened down with situations and different things. Hallelujah. But it's good to know that I could call you. You could pray for me. And I could pray for you. And hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Every time I think about you, every time I read about you, every time I hear your name, I start to smile. Every time the sun starts shining, every time the wind starts blowing, every time I feel your anointing, I start to smile. Let me take the time to say I love you. Let me take this time to say I care. I love you, Lord.
Hallelujah, Jesus. If you know it, sing along with me. Hallelujah. Come on. Every time I think about you, glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Every time I think about you, every time I read about you, every time I hear your name, I start to smile. Every time the sun starts shining, every time the winds start blowing, every time I feel your anointing, I start to smile. Let me take the time to say I love you. Let me take the time to say I care. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Every time I think about you, every time I read about you, every time I hear your name, I start to smile. Every time the sun starts shining, every time the wind starts blowing, every time I feel your anointing, I start to smile. Let me take the time to say I love you. Let me
to say I care. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. Every time I think about you, every time I read about you, every time I hear your name, I start to smile. Every time the sun starts shining, every time the wind starts blowing, every time I feel your anointing, I start to smile. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. I'm in love with Jesus, and he's in love with me. Every time I think about you, every time I read about you, every time I hear your name, I start to smile. Every time the sun starts shining, every time the wind starts blowing, every time I feel your anointing, I start to smile. Let me take the time to say I love you. Let me take the time to say I care. I love you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to prepare to take up our offering at this time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, all that he's done for me, I get so excited, just can't hold my peace. Been a present help, in the time of troubles. The Lord is always there. Through the stormy weather, he's been good. Sure enough good, he's been good. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, all that he's done for me, I get so excited, just can't hold my peace. Been a present help in the time of troubles. The Lord is always there through the stormy weather. He's been good, sure enough good. He's been good to me. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. He's been good.
He's been good.
Sure enough good.
Sure enough good.
He's been good.
He's been good to me.
When I think of the goodness of Jesus, all that he's done for me, I get so excited, just can't hold my peace. Been a present help in the time of trouble. The Lord is always there through the stormy weather. He's been good,
he's been good.
Sure enough good. He's been good to me. Well, every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. He's been good, sure enough good. He's been good, he's been good to me. Well, every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. He's been good, sure enough good. He's been good to me. Well, every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. He's been good, sure enough good. He's been good to me. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, all that he's done for me, I get so excited, just can't hold my peace. Been a present help in the time of trouble. The Lord is always there through the stormy weather. He's been good, sure enough good. He's been good to me. Well, every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. Every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he gives me the victory. He's been good, sure enough good. He's been good to me. Sure enough 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 good to me. Sure enough, he sure enough good to me. Sure enough good to me. Sure enough, he's sure enough good to me. 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 Showing up 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 good to me. Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The words of the song say, when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, hallelujah, I get so excited I just can't hold my peace. Hallelujah. I know the devil thought I wouldn't have made it here this morning to give God some praise, but hallelujah, I'm here to testify that I shall not die, but I shall live to declare the works of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And I'm not going to let anything separate me from the love of God. Hallelujah. It's such a horrible week last week, but I thank God, hallelujah, that I can still give God the praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Because I know he is in control. He is still in control. And when I think of the goodness of Jesus, hallelujah, and all that he's done for me, the innermost part of my soul cries out, hallelujah, because I'm thanking him for the victory this morning. Hallelujah. Glory to God. No matter what happens, I'm just thanking God for the victory this morning, because I am not a victim, but because of Jesus, I am victorious. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I don't know about anybody else, but I can always find something to praise God for. Amen. Hallelujah. I shouldn't have made it out here this morning, but I'm always going to press my way out for the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, because I'm trusting God that it is well. It is well with my soul. Hallelujah. No matter what's going on, it's hard, but it is well with my soul. Hallelujah. Because I trust in the Lord, and I know he's making it all right. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. I trust you, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for every situation. Hallelujah. Every hard time, Lord, because I know that you are in control. God, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I bless your name, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I honor you, Lord. I lift you up this morning, Lord. I praise you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. I thank you for who you are to me, God. Hallelujah. I bless your name, Lord. I thank you. I praise you. I lift you up, Lord. You're so worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Good morning. Let us all say, thank you, Jesus. God is good. All the time, God is good. I give God thanks and praise for allowing me to come again and worship with my baby brother. And I got a shock this morning. My sister-in-law said, I want you to introduce your brother. I say, what? But I would just like to introduce, you all know him, my baby brother, Samuel, Reverend Samuel Boone. And it is just a joy for God to allow me to come from Ohio a couple of times a year to see him. Amen. I'm so proud of him. And so proud that God saved them. Let the church say amen. But he is, to you and to God, his son, that gives us, as my daddy used to say, the unadulterated gospel. And I give God for him. I present to all of you this morning the Reverend Elder Samuel Boone.
Praise the Lord, everybody. So glad for that introduction from my older sister. Amen. 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 I thank God. You know, when you think about the goodness of the Lord, sometimes you wonder why God
did that for me. You understand? Because I could have thought of a lot of other peoples. He could have probably saved, probably healed, probably delivered, but he did it for me. You understand? He somehow, somewhere along the line, he thought about me first. Ain't that true? And I thank him because he's such a what when in this whole world to just spot you. Amen. You know how many billions of people out there that he could have grabbed, he could have saved, but he thought about you, that one individual. Somebody say, you count your salvation as just nothing? I count it as everything. There's nothing greater than being saved and sanctified and filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. We thank God for you today. If you have your programs, we're going to go into our lesson this morning, coming from out of the book of St. John, the familiar scripture for this Easter Sunday. We're saying happy Easter to each and every one of you. Thank God for you. St. John, the 11th chapter, we're starting from verse 17, and we're going to read down to verse 27. If you need a Bible, please raise your hands. They give you a Bible. You're going to need it anyway, because I'm going to go through a lot of scriptures today. St. John, 11th chapter, verse 17 through verse 27. Let us stand for the reading of God's word. And it reads, then when Jesus came, he found that he had laid in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh to Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he was dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She said unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. Let the church say amen. Remain standing for a moment of prayer. We thank God for the reading of his word. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we thank you for this moment and for this hour, Lord, to be used as an instrument in your hand and unto your glory and unto your praise. Lord, open unto us words of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Let your word go forth. Let it build up. Let it encourage. Let it heal, Father, we pray, and we thank you for it. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, touch each and every one that's here. Father, you know their needs and you know their desire, Father. We ask in the name of Jesus that you would meet it according to your riches and glory. In Jesus' name, and let the church say, amen. This morning we'll be talking about the revelation of Jesus, the resurrection, and the life. We give honor to the Spirit of Christ, to each and every one here this morning, Reverend, and everybody. My husband's been coming all the way down from Ohio. We thank God for them. Every time they come down, we have a good time. And every time we go on trips, we have a good time. It's a blessing to have them at the house. We praise God for them. When we think of the word revelation means an uncovering, an unveiling, or a disclosure. In the New Testament, this word describes the unveiling of spiritual truth. Paul tells us, in 1 Corinthians, in that 15th chapter, a chapter, a verse that everybody loves to read, especially Christians, I know. And Paul said, behold, I show you a mystery. He said, we shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. He says, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. He said, the last trumpet, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. It's a great mystery that the world don't know about. It's a great mystery that God revealed it to the Apostle Paul to let us all know that everybody is not going to die. There will be some folks alive. And those who are alive at the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he said a phenomenal thing is going to happen in their lives. He doesn't give us all the details of how it's going to take place, but he said that in the moment and the twinkling of an eye, he said, we are going to be changed. That's a hope to look for too, huh? And then, but he said, but you won't change until those who are in the grave rise first, huh? So the dead in Christ are going to rise first, and we which are alive remain, the Bible says, we shall be changed. That's a great revelation to know as a child of God. Another thing the Bible tells us about that's a great mystery that folks don't know and give us the revelation. In the book of St. John, in the first chapter of St. John, it tells us in the first verse, we're going to read down to that 14th verse, it says, in the beginning was the Word. And it said, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It said, the same was in the beginning with God. It said, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. It said, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth it not. He said, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lightens every man that comes into the world. He says that he was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But he said, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believed on his name, which were born not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, not the will of man, but of God. And then this great revelation he gives us in that 14th verse. He said, that Word was made flesh, and it dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And we thank God for the incarnation. We thank God for God becoming a man and walking down here on the earth. People didn't know who he was. But John said, he made the world, and he was in the world, huh? All things, he say, was made by him, and yet and still nobody knew him. God had to reveal himself unto us. And I thank God for the Word, huh? In all its uses, revelation refers to something or someone once hidden, but all of a sudden now becoming visible. This revelation, God tells us in the book of Matthew, can only come through him. If God doesn't show it to you, God doesn't open up your eyes, you'll never know who Jesus is. Peter thought that it was his own opinion. He thought it was his wisdom and his smart intelligence. But Jesus had to bring him down to size. In Matthew 16 and verse 16, in fact, I'm going to go up a little further. 13th verse. Say, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples, said, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and some others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Then he said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said to him, blessed art thou, Simon by Jonah. He said, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. I often hear people sometimes they believe that it was their opinion and their thoughts and their will that brought them to Christ. But the Bible reveals us that if God don't bring you, you can't come. If God don't open up your eyes and reveal to you who Jesus is, you'll never recognize him. Huh? Simon thought he knew something nobody else knew. And he thought it was because of his own smartness or wisdom. But God, Jesus had to let him know, no, it was not you. Nothing that you learned in school, nothing that your mother and father taught you, but my Father, he revealed it unto you. He has to do it. And I'm so thankful that when it came to Jesus in the time that he was walking here upon the earth, in fact, at this time, even when Jesus was saying all these things, when it came to Martha and Mary, everybody was listening to this fella going around saying that he was one with God and that he was the Son of God himself. And in fact, the people were looking at him in such confusion until they said, he must be demon possessed. He must be a madman, because they looking at him through their own eyes. I'm telling you, when you look at Jesus with a natural point of view, it does look kind of crazy. Have somebody dead on the cross, you say he's alive. Have somebody dead on the cross, you say he saved the whole world. Have somebody whipped and accused of being a thief and a robber, but you say he's the Son of God. It's confusion when you look at it, because you can't believe somebody who's a Son of God and he's hanging on the cross and he's dying. You see, that has to be a revelation given to you in order for you to understand this is the Savior. This is the Son of God. This is your only way out of death and damnation. He is the one. But when you look at it from your own point of view, it sounds crazy. You know, it's like when somebody came and told me, they said, you need to be saved. Huh? I said, yeah, I don't see nothing wrong with me. I need to be saved. You need your sins forgiven. What sins, huh? I didn't think nothing was wrong with me, huh? But somewhere along the line, I saw. My eyes opened. The words I had been hearing ever since I was a child all of a sudden became real to me. I've heard Jesus save many times, huh? But I still didn't think I needed to be saved, huh? I've heard about forgiveness of sin a many times, but I still didn't think my sins bothered anybody. I felt like I could get in on mama and daddy prayers, huh? But God had to reveal to me, you need to be saved. You might have felt like that one time when you was around here running along the street and somebody just all of a sudden it hit you. You need to be saved. God just all of a sudden just take that veil off of your eyes. God all of a sudden take that hardness out of your heart. And he tell you, you need to be saved. That's why I say, you have to have a revelation. You can't come to him when you feel like it. Often here when Deacon Johnson always said, he thought he was doing God a favor when he got saved. He felt like God should have been proud that he came to him, not knowing that he got a favor. God did him a favor and bringing him to Christ. So the thing is, we have to have a revelation. We just can't come to God when we feel like it. We just can't come on our own. But God has to reveal Christ to us. He has to open up our eyes. And the thing is, this is a well-known story in the scripture. And I like to always go back to the beginning and then come up to my text. Let's go back to that first verse. And let's just give you a summary of what went on until we get to the point where Jesus reveals who he is. It says in that 11th and first verse, it says, now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, of the town of Mary and her sister Martha. And it was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. They therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest, he say, is sick. And the thing is this here. We know it says that they love Jesus. And they felt like because they love Jesus and they opened up their house all the way to Jesus, that when Jesus got the word that Lazarus was sick, and this was a life-threatening sickness, and in fact, it actually took his life. Huh? They felt like when Jesus heard the seriousness of the sickness, that he just jumped right on the first horse or the first donkey, going to Jerusalem, getting there Bethany as fast as he can. I believe they felt like that was going to happen. But I want you to understand something. There are things that God does that sometimes we don't understand. Lazarus was sick. That's a due fact. The Bible says he was sick, but notice what it says in that fourth verse. It said, but when Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Jesus lets us know two things right there in that fourth verse. One thing he lets us know, Lazarus' sickness is not for death. He ain't gonna be a prey to death. Death ain't gonna have the final word. Ain't that a blessing to know? No matter when death come, it's not going to have the final say. He said, look, death is not going to take him out, but he's not going to have the final word. He let us know that this is for the glory of him and for the glory of God. Now, another thing he lets us know, that God don't receive any glory in death. That's not his glory. He lets us know God don't receive no glory in sin. So God's got to get the glory out of conquering death. And God gets the glory when he brings you out of sin and saves you. Believe it or not, he brought you out of death. Another thing, God don't get no glory out of you being sick. You sitting up there talking about, well, this is of the Lord. No, God don't get no glory out of sickness. Where God get the glory is where you come out of that sickness. When he heals your body, that gives God the glory. I'm so glad God don't get glory in bad things. God don't get no glory in sin. God don't get no glory in sickness. But God gets the glory when he delivers you, when he saves you, when he brings you out from that sickness and that pain. That gives God the glory. And he say, look, this is for the glory of God, and this is also for the glory of Christ. And the reason he says it's for the glory of Christ, in St. John 5 and 23, he said that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He said, he that honors not the Son honors not the Father which has sent him. He want you to know, I'm God, and I want you to honor me just like you honor God. He said, look, I got the power to give life, and I got the power to heal. I got the power to raise the dead. And he said, I want you to understand and give me honor. This is for our glory. And then we read down a little bit more farther. It said that Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And when he had heard therefore that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Then after that, he said unto the disciples, let us go to Judea again. Look, a lot of people get confused about this Jesus staying 2 more days. You say you love him, and they love you, but you get confused a lot of times about this here. But I want you to look, if you all know the definition that the Bible gives us of charity, and when you think about it, Jesus had a great love for this family. But when you look at the word, it says about charity. One thing it starts off with in 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 3 and verse 4, it said, love is patient and love is kind. Look at here. Don't get in no hurry when you love somebody. And don't be in a hurry when somebody loves you. You understand? Because it said love is patient. He ain't acting unseemly, because it said love doesn't act unseemly. Doesn't behave itself unseemly. He's doing nothing wrong. This is still love. But he's trying to teach them something. And I thank God for love. Love involves waiting. Sometimes you have to wait for that thing to come to pass. Sometimes in love, love is patient. It endures all things, bears all things. That's love. When you can't bear nothing, when you can't endure nothing, and you say you love somebody, you better go back and check your Bible. Bible definition, because it said love is patient, love is kind. Oh yes, he stayed there for 2 days, but they still should love him. Yes, he looked like he don't love them in your point of view, but he loves them. But there's a purpose behind whatever God is doing. A lot of time we think because God don't move and act at the time that we think he should, we feel like he don't love us. But I'm here to tell you, love is kind. Love is patient. Even though he didn't come when you wanted him to come, he still loves you. Even though he didn't do it the way you thought he ought to done it, he still loves you. Because love, is it works in a good way. And look at here. Don't give up on God's love. His love get past a lot of things. It's about to tell them that love covers a multitude of faults. Look at here. If God was to act real quick sometime I guess we'll always look for it to come that way. But sometimes God wants us to learn something. He wants us to learn to wait on God. There's a time when God's going to work. Sometimes it's not in your watch. Sometimes it's not on your calendar. Sometimes it's not in your day. But God is going to work. I told you he don't get no glory in sin. I told you he don't get no glory in your sickness. He don't get no glory in you being defeated. So God's going to help you. God's going to show up because he wants some glory. But God got to get you into a position where you can wait on God. The Bible tells us when he heard that, he stayed there 2 more days. Now I'm going to tell you, boy, look here. One of the hardest things it seems to do as a Christian is to learn to wait upon God. Huh? That's one hard thing to do. Especially if you severely ill and the doctors done came with all them bad reports and you were still looking for God to show up somewhere. And the Bible say, but you got to learn how to wait. And waiting it's a class you got to go to. Some teaching got to be done to you. You just ain't born with patience. You just ain't born with the ability to hang around for a while in trouble, in severe sickness, and things are not, everything just falling down around you. It's kind of hard to stand there and wait. But the Bible tells us, wait on God. In fact, in Psalms 25:5. David says this here. He said, lead me in thy truth and teach me. He said, for thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day. David said, look, waiting, it's going to lead me. Waiting, it's going to teach me. He said, I'll wait all day on God if it takes that. He said, because it's going to teach me something. Then in Psalm 27:14, we all know wait on the Lord. It say it'll give you good courage and he shall strengthen that heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Look at here. You get some good courage waiting on God. You get some strength waiting on God. He said he'll strengthen that heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. And then in Psalm 62:5, David says, my soul, wait thou only upon God, for my expectation is from him. When you waiting, you ain't just sitting up under the shade tree drinking you some Kool-Aid, but you waiting with an expectation. The mailman coming, I know he coming, so I'm hanging around the mailbox. And the rain is coming, you better get your chariot and get the run, because I hear abundance of rain. It hadn't rained in 3.5 years, but the prophet say I hear abundance of rain. He said, I'm gonna wait on God. David said, look, all my expectations is in him. Because if I'm gonna come out of this sickness, it's because of God. If I'm gonna get out of this trouble, it's because of God. And if God is your only hope, you should have no problem waiting on God. Amen. See, I learned how to wait. I found it out. That there's some good things in waiting. Everything don't have to be Burger King. Having it your way. Sometimes you have to sit around and listen. And sometimes you have to sit around and sometimes you have to go through pains and suffering. Go through some accusations. False accusations against you. Sometimes you have to go through tribulation. But if your expectation is in God, you're going to wait. One thing I found out, if you out there in the ocean and all you got is a lifeboat, you ain't got no other way of getting to land. You got to wait for that helicopter or for somebody to come by with a ship or a boat to pick you up. And if you know that's your only hope, you're going to sit on that boat. You ain't gonna jump off your boat and jump in the water. You said, no, somebody gonna come this way. Somebody gonna save me. Somebody gonna deliver me. If you know your God is a deliverer, you're gonna wait on him. If you know your God is a healer, you're gonna wait on him. If you know your God can do all things, you going to wait on him. I go in that class every now and then. Every now and then I got to go in that class and I got to get my degrees. Waiting. I got to go in that class and study. Waiting. I got to go in that class and take my tests on. Waiting. Because every now and then I'm short patient. Every now and then I can't get them quick to do something I ain't got no business doing. And God say, you just wait. You see some things that God show you and you want it to come tomorrow. But God say, you got to wait. You ain't ready for some of the things that God showed you and some of the things God say he's going to do for you. You ain't ready for it. So God say, you got to wait. Look here. If it was up to Joseph, he would have went to the throne the day he saw his brothers bowing down to him. But God said, no, it ain't your time yet. You got to wait. And he had to wait 13 years before he got that vision fulfilled. David, you figure after Samuel pulled the oil on him, that he should have went right on up there, kicked old Saul off the throne and said, look, I'm the new king. But he had to wait. And he had to wait a lot of years. See, sometimes God got a plan for your life. You want it right away, but you gotta wait. Sometimes you got to learn patience. Sometimes you got to learn endurance. Sometimes you got to learn faith. You got to increase your faith, your love, all these things. God said, I'm waiting on you to get those fruits manifested in your life. And so while you waiting, God is molded. You see, because when the artist, when he see the lump of clay, he see the finished effect. And it may, you might say, well, why he just don't jump on it and get it done right away? But it takes him some time. He sculptures, he takes off this, he adds that, he grooves this, and it takes time. But in the end, he got a masterpiece, all because he didn't just jump right in and just do anything, but it took his time. God said, look, Mary, y'all got to learn something. You, Martha, and Lazarus, y'all got to learn something. Sometimes you have to wait. I know everybody in here probably didn't suffer with some sickness a lot longer than you wanted to. I'm sure there's trouble in your life, and you were saying to God, how long, Lord? He got you in that school of waiting. He got you in that school with the clock chalkboard writing different things that you need to learn about waiting. And if you just learn, it'll lead you, it'll teach you, it'll give you good courage, it'll strengthen you, it'll bring all your expectations to pass. But you got to learn that lesson of waiting. So today, he said, let us go to Jerusalem. Let's drop down to that 11th verse. These things said he after that, he said unto them, he said, our friend Lazarus sleepeth. But he said, but I go that I may awaken him out of his sleep. Then said the disciple, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought he had spoken of taking a rest in sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. I want to look at three things in those few verses. First thing is sleep. A lot of people think that when folks go down in the grave, they down there in the grave. But the only thing in the grave is the body. It's only the body of the believer that sleep. It's not the soul and the spirit, because immediately we go into the presence of the Lord. Another thing I want you to understand, Jesus said, look, I'm going to awake him. He said, he's our friend, and I'm going to awake him out of his sleep. In other words, I'm going to raise this man from the dead. Ain't that something? He said, look, I'm going to awake him. Then he said, our friend. I love that. He said, I got to go awake my friend. Now, you don't go say that to some dead person. But Jesus said, look, I got to go awake our friend. I'm going to read this here because I don't want to mess this up, because this is too good for me. Jesus called Lazarus our friend. He was dead, but he was still our friend. And this is a hint that Lazarus is still a friend despite being dead, that he is still living, alive in another world. Do you believe that? Jesus said, he's my friend. Lazarus partying somewhere, y'all. Lazarus having a cool, good time somewhere. And we thinking he dead. And Jesus said, he's my friend. And I'm going to awaken him. Not only that, he said that Jesus stated very plainly what he was going to do. He said Lazarus was asleep, therefore he was going to awaken Lazarus out of his sleep. But the disciples, they didn't understand what he was saying. By sleep, Jesus meant that Lazarus was dead, but they thought Jesus was talking about he was rested. Because when somebody's been sick and you find out they sleeping, you say, oh, he all right then. But Jesus said, no, Lazarus is dead. Look, I told some people on my job one time, they was all brokenhearted and down because they had lost one of their best friends. And it looked like they just was all dead and depressed that day. And the chaplain couldn't do nothing for them. So the chaplain called me. He said, look, come, you got to say something to these people. They're too depressed. They're too downhearted. And God gave me this scripture. He said, our friend. And I say, he's your friend. You all thinking he's dead and he's gone. But he alive. He's still alive. Still living. And he's still your friend. Every believer that's died is my friend. And every believer that's died, he's still alive in another world. Thank God some folks don't believe that. But I said if they did, they'd definitely live a different way, because he is alive. And then the thing is this here. Look at what it says in that 15th verse. He said, I'm glad. Lord have mercy. He said, I'm glad for your sake. He said that I was not there, to the intent that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Ain't that an astonishing thing to say about my brother? Somebody he loved. He said, I'm glad I wasn't there. Why he was glad? I'd have been there, he wouldn't have died. I'd have been there, he would have gotten healed. But he said, but I'm glad I'm not there. Look at here. What make God happy is that when he's getting ready to take you to another level of faith. You see, you sometimes get comfortable right where you are, knowing what you know, and thinking that you done got all that you can get. So God said, I'm glad I wasn't there. Because if I'd have been there, you'd have got what you usually get. You'd have got your brother healed, and he would not have died. But he said, but I'm glad I wasn't there, so that your faith can take a leap, so that you can go up a little higher. I'm glad for some of the things God have shown me. I wasn't glad when it was going on, but I'm glad today, because it caused my faith to take a leap. You're never going to take a leap going at the same old thing, doing the same. If God don't do something new and exciting in your life, if God don't shake things up sometime, if God don't mix it up, if God don't rock your boat every now and then, you'll never take that extra step. You'll never take that extra leap of faith. So he said, I'm glad y'all used to me healing everybody. So I'm glad y'all used to me doing all these miracles. So I'm glad. I want you to go a little higher.
fire. I'm going to do something that you ain't think I could do. God said, so I'm glad I wasn't there. Lord, have mercy. I want to grow in Christ. We say that all the time. I want the Lord to bring me closer. We say that all the time. I want to get higher and higher in the Lord. We say that all the time. I'm telling you, when you make that statement, expect the storm to come. Expect the rope, the boat to rock. Expect it to be something that you never expected before. Because God wants you to take that leap of faith. He don't want you to just sit in the boat and be comfortable. But he says, step out of the boat and start walking on the water. God wants your faith to take a leap. Look, I'm glad I would have got mad. He said, he glad. But God's going to do something. James said, count it all joy when you fall in the dire temptation. You say, look, I don't know. But I'm here to tell you, my greatest revelations came when I was in trouble. My greatest revelations came when it looked like I was depressed. My greatest revelations came when it looked like all I could do was failing. My greatest revelations of God came at those moments. I never know God could bring me out. Never know God would have made a way. Never know God would have brought me through. I always at those point in time thinking that it's all over with, thinking that I'm defeated, and God shows up. Look at here. Don't get sorrow and get all mad. James said, get glad. He said, the trying of your faith is at hand. God's trying to mature your faith. God's trying to get your faith to go up to another level. You may not like what you're in, but be joyous because God's getting ready to raise you up, take you to another level. I thank God for my trials. I thank God for my trouble. Paul said, look, I went to him about that thorn in my flesh, and he wouldn't remove it. And when I found out why he didn't remove it, he opened up my eyes to something new. He said, my grace is sufficient for thee. But in thy weakness, I'm going to get strong. Paul said, look, I'm glad now for my troubles. I'm glad now for my suffering. I'm glad now for my persecution. He said, for when I am weak, then am I strong. He never would have got that revelation if it wasn't for that thorn. But when that thorn came into his life, it opened up his eyes to something new about God. God's still there. Even though it looked like the devil's winning, God is still there. I'm glad I wasn't there. So your faith can go to another level. Sometimes I hear you all testifying. I mean, I couldn't get Pastor Boone on the phone. Couldn't get Sister Boone. Couldn't find y'all. But the Lord worked it out. I said, ain't that something? Been telling them all along, God will work it out. But they had to see it for themselves. And I thank God for that leap of faith. When they tell me, look, I used to be crying all night long about something. But you know, I found out them tears didn't change the situation. I found out that depression, all that sorrow in my life didn't change the situation. I finally gave it up and I gave it over to God. And all that that's left, I said, thank you, God, for that leap of faith. Because I'm going to tell you, every time you see your children going from stage to stage and you see them leaping and leaping, bounds and bounds, you say, I'm thanking God they're growing up. I'm thanking God they're learning how to take care of themselves. I'm thanking God they're dealing with life situations. Situation, and they're being strong, they're being men, they're being women. You be glad about it. And that's the same way God looks at you. God said, look, I don't want you to just be in those same routine. I want you to learn something. I'm going to tell you something. It says he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. That sound like the same. Sound like the same routine going on all the time. But when it say he's the same, look, he's always moving. He's always changing. changing. He's always bringing about something new. And the thing is about it, every time you think you done figured him out, he changes. You think he's on the left, he moved to the right. You think he's over there, he sits over there. He ain't gonna never let you figure him out. You'll never put him in a box. That's why I tell people, don't lock him up, because he can't be locked up. Always remember, there's a way out with God. Bible tell you, there has no temptation taken you, but such as is coming to man. But God is faithful. I'm going to tell you something. He's faithful. You can't make him out of a liar. You can't change him. He's going to be there. He said, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation make a way for you to escape. I'm always, when it look like it's about to go over my head, I'm looking for a rubber ducky. I'm looking for a rope. I'm looking for something to bring me out, because there got to be a way of escape. Got to be a door I didn't know. Got to be an exit way I didn't find out about. But there's always a way. God ain't gonna let you be overcome by your situation, but he's always trying to let you know, I got a door open and there's a way out. I thank God. And so the thing is, this is, I'm glad I wasn't there, to the intent you may believe. Nevertheless, let's go to him. Just let him know. He said, look, we got an opportunity, because we got some daylight still here. He said, night come, no man can work. And then when Jesus, verse 17, when Jesus came, he found that he had been laid in the grave for 4 days already. And the thing is about this is, can you see the grace of God? Huh? When you look and you see God's grace coming, huh? He coming despite the death. He's coming despite of what people are saying. Think about him. He's coming because he loves you. And the only way we can see God's grace is that we got to see it in Jesus. Jesus shows us the grace of God. God is concerned. God really understands your problems. And he's coming to rescue you. And the Bible says he waited 4 days. And the fourth day, the decomposition began to set in. And so there is no doubt. They know there is no doubt. He is dead. He is a dead man. And then let's look at verse 21. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, he said, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou would ask God, God will give it thee. I often say that because people limit God. She said, look, Lord, if you'd have been here. In other words, it's too late. Lord, if thou had been here, my brother would not have died. That's a true statement. She believed Jesus would have healed him. She believed Jesus would have prevented the sorrow that she was in. But since he's dead, and he's been dead now for 4 days, God can't work now. Look at here. If you 90 years old and you 100 years old and God ain't worked for 90 years, what make you think he gonna give you a baby at 90 years old? You see, God wants your faith to increase. God said, look there, I know you always looked and seen I can heal. But he said, Lord, if you'd have been here. I call this limited faith. We get to a point where we stop believing. We get to a point where we say, God, it's over with. God can't do nothing about this. But you know something. With God, all things are possible. And if it's possible, there's no limit placed on it. You can't put a limit when the Bible says all things are possible. impossible with God. And see, she limit God. She said, my brother done been in the grave 4 days. There's nothing God can do. She's done put a capsize on it. If he's in that grave, especially if he's been there 4 days, there's nothing God can do. Look at the impossible situation. This is calling God, because when it's impossible, it's calling for God. Bible say when men, it's impossible, but not with God. It say for all things are possible with God. Take your limit off God. She's saying, God, if you'd have came here, if you'd have acted this way, if you'd have done this or that, my brother would have been alive. She got a limit there, but Jesus got to let her know. Look, get that limit, faith. You believe God for a job, but you don't think God can pay your bills. You believe God for a house, but you don't think God can put furniture in the house. You believe God to heal you for a cold, but you don't believe God when it comes to cancer. Take your limit off of God. Don't say God can't do this. That's a cuss word to God. You can't? What's wrong with you? He had to tell Sarah, is there anything too hard for God? Sarah laughed because she said, hey, I'm going to have a baby. That sounds funny to me. A lot of things God says he's going to do for you might sound ridiculous, might sound funny, but take your limit off of God and understand all things are possible with God. She said, Lord, if thou had been here. She said, but I know it, whatever you ask God, he's going to do it for you. And Jesus said something that probably shocked her. I'm sure it shocked her. He said this here in verse 23. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Clearly, no doubt about it. Plain and simple. He said, thy brother shall rise again. You know, we got to figure out our way of believing that. We got to put a spin on it. She says in the next verse, Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. I know at the end, everybody who's in the grave going to rise again. I know that. I've heard the teaching of the prophets. I've heard that. You're going to rise again. But she was thinking about some future day. This made her more acceptable. But I want you to understand something. Jesus says this to her in verse 25. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He said, he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. I always thought when you preached or taught the revelation of resurrection of life, that you was teaching a doctrine. I didn't know that the resurrection and life was a person. You don't teach it a lot of time as a person. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. I'm not a teaching. I'm not just a belief. I am. I'm the source of life. I give life to everything. I'm the one that brought life into the distance. In him, the Bible say, was life. And he lighteth every man that cometh into the world. I'm standing right here in front of you. John said, that which was from the beginning, which we have handled, which we have seen with our eyes, the word of life. John said, look, that source that caused me to walk, that source that caused me to breathe, he's standing right here in front of me, that gives life to the birds, give life to the fish, give life to the animal, that what causes the tree to grow, that what causes the grass to grow, he's standing right here. He's not a teaching, he's not a doctrine, it's a person. People sometimes they call the Holy Spirit like it's a spirit, but the Holy Spirit is a person. He said, look, when he, the Spirit of truth is come, he shall, he's using a personal name, a pronoun, he, look, He ain't no portion. People say, I got 2/3 of the Holy Ghost. No. You either got it, Holy Ghost, or no Holy Ghost. Because he's a person. I don't have my sister when I got a finger. I got my sister finger, but I ain't got her. But when you get a whole person, you got everything. And Jesus said, look, when you talking about life, you talking about me. This is a revelation that she didn't know. Oh, I believe in the resurrection, but it's a future thing. Jesus said, it's not a future thing. It's a person. I'm the person. I'm the resurrection. I'm the life. You look, Marsha, you see life. Your brother is dead, but life stands right here in front of you. He said, look, I'm the resurrection and the life. Then he gives us, believers, 2 promises. I'm so glad for these promises. My aunt, I was at her funeral yesterday, and I was thinking about these 2 promises that he gives us. Look what he says. He said this here, he that believes in me, he said, though he were dead, he said, yet shall he live. Oh, Lord, have mercy. What we got to say about this here? He said, look, I want to show you. I want to read it because I want you to understand. He said, he that believes in me, though he died, yet shall he live. The believer who has passed from this world is fully alive. He lives in heaven, in the other world, in the very presence of God himself. Another world exists just as this world exists. It's not a world that lies out in the future. It is a world that exists now, a spiritual world, a world that the Bible calls heaven, the place where God, the angels, and all the believers have gone on. He said, he that believes in me, even though he died, he's alive in another world. He's living. He's going on. He ain't dead. He's alive. I remember Jesus had to talk to the Sadducees one time because they said they didn't believe in the resurrection. And they said, look, this man had so many wives. This woman had so many husbands. And he said, when she get to heaven, who's her husband going to be? And they thought that they had him tricked. They had him trapped. But I'm here to tell you, he said, you do misunderstand the scripture, because some people believe that when you die, your body and your spirit and your soul lays in the grave. That's not true. Some people believe when you die, you go to a place called purgatory and you wait to get all fixed up. That's not true. God says, look, the moment he dies, he goes into the presence of the Lord. The Bible said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, then he says something else in verse 26. And he said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me, he said, shall never die. He said, believeth thou this. The second promise. Look at here. If you don't believe, before I go to the second promise, I just got to tell you something. Go to the book of Luke, the 9th chapter. If you don't think that the saints who have died are still alive today, look what it says in Luke 9:30 and 31. It said, this is Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. You all know the story. It said, behold, there talked with him 2 men. Notice their names, which was Moses. Man died hundreds of years, thousands of years ago. And Elijah, another man, went straight on up into heaven, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he should accomplish at Jerusalem. Not only that, go to Luke 23 and 43. When he was on the cross, he said this to the thief. He said, Jesus said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, today shall thou be with me in paradise. That's another world. That's a spiritual world. That's another place. People don't understand. This is not the real world. The real world is where God is. That's where my auntie is today. She went there a few days ago. ago. She left this world because she believed in him. And she's still alive because he said, if you believe, you'll never see death. Look at what it says. Whosoever, then he said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me, he says, shall never die. Now the second promise, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. The idea is that the believer shall never taste death. That is, never experience death. Quicker than the believer can blink an eye, he passes from this world into the next world. He's transported and transferred into heaven. The believer never loses a single moment of consciousness. One moment he's conscious living in this world, and the next moment he's conscious and present in the next world. You never lose a moment of consciousness. Jesus said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me, he say, shall never die. Ain't that something? The moment they lose consciousness with us, they wake up with consciousness with God. They don't never meet death. They don't never talk to death. Just say, you pass from life to, pass from death to life. Look at what it says in John 5 and 24. He say, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my words and believeth on him that sent me, he say, he has already, has everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Look here. Lose consciousness with this world, wake up with consciousness in the other world. Don't never lose a moment of sleep. Don't never see a moment of darkness. Because you know, when you go to sleep, you close your eyes, and you all of a sudden there's blackness. You out of touch with the world. But Jesus said, if you live and believe in me, you never lose consciousness. You just keep right on going. You go from one consciousness in this world and then into the next consciousness in the other world. You don't never meet death. You go right into the presence of the Lord. One moment. Some people say, well, I got to wait for God to get me ready. No. Some folks say, I got to wait for the angels to come. No. He said, you that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. You ain't gonna never go out of, you ain't gonna never lose consciousness. That isn't that a blessing to know that when you leave this world, you're right immediately in the other world. Isn't it a blessing to know, just as conscious as you are of this world, you will be even more conscious of the other world. And it's quack, it's faster than the moment and the twinkling of an eye. You from one consciousness to another consciousness, you will never die. Lord have mercy. That's worth living for. That's worth believing in. That's worth lifting Jesus up as the highest. That's worth it all. He said, look, Martha, believest thou this? All he asking you to do. Do you believe it? Do you believe you never lose consciousness as a child of God? Do you believe that you go from one world? You hear these people who are in coma. They say, look, I was walking around in heaven. I saw this. I heard this. You said to yourself, but you was in a coma. You was no, he wasn't unconscious. His body was unconscious. He was walking around like Paul said. When they hit me with them rocks and they knocked me out and they left me for dead, he said, I was still conscious. They thought I was unconscious, but I was conscious walking around in the third heaven. He said, I heard things and saw things. He said, I can't tell you about, but I was conscious. They walking around looking at me as if I was dead, but I wasn't dead. I was over in the other world, checking out my new home, checking out my place, where I'm going to be after a while. He said, I was all over there walking around while y'all walking around looking at my dead, beat up body. I'm walking around my new home thinking about my glorified body. You ain't gonna never die. People get scared of death. Scared of what? You ain't going to sleep. You going from one world right into the next world. And you gotta believe that, because the Bible tells us about the rapture. It says, in the moment and the twinkling of an eye, you go from one world right into the other world. He said, we shall be changed. Lord have mercy. That's resurrection, y'all. That's life. Jesus said, look, it ain't no doctrine. It's me. I'm the resurrection. I'm the life. You looking for a teaching. You looking for a plan. Look for Jesus. Because in him is life. And you can't, I'm going to tell you that. See, I wrote this down. You know, Jesus, told somebody, said one time, look, you think you can search the scripture and you think you're going to find life, but you find that it's all talking about me. It's all about Jesus. Nobody else. And the thing is, I want to hurry up again. Got to get out of the way because I don't want to hold y'all too long. Go down to that verse 33 of that same chapter and try to close it out. He said, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? And they said to him, Lord, come and see. Say, Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of the men said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus, therefore, again groaning in himself, comes to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time, he thinketh, and for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, thou wouldst see the glory of God. Some people's, you know, they want God, but then they don't want God. Martha was unsure. She didn't understand what God's getting ready to do for her. You see, some folks, they say, don't rock the boat if everything's going along well. Huh? Don't shake things up. Huh? Don't disturb nothing. Huh? He in the grave. Just leave him in the grave. Huh? But she wanted Jesus to come and heal her brother. And he done told her, say, look, your brother is going to rise again. But she said, look, let everything be like it is. Don't disturb nothing. Just let the rock stay there. Just let him stay in the grave. Everything good now. Some folks just want to be at ease. Don't want God to demand nothing of them. But he said, but didn't I tell you? So I'm going to tell you something. God wants you to understand. You need to grow. You got to come up. You need to get a little higher. You all sitting back and relax, and you ain't got all the blessings of the Lord. You all sitting back and relax, and you ain't found out how powerful God is. You sitting back and relax, and God waiting to do all kinds of things for you, but you say, no, don't rock the boat. Just leave him like he is. He's thinking. We don't want to open up nothing else. Somebody said, don't open up that can. We don't want none of that trouble. But God said, look, I got to open up that can because I want to let you know that trouble you feel, I got power over. That thing that you think you can't get over, I got power to bring you through. He said, look, just leave him. We all right now. I'm going to tell you, every time, sometimes, like we can get comfortable with the devil beating us up over our head, with the devil tying our hands up, with the devil causing all kinds. We just, well, I guess I just have to go through this. No, sir. Jesus said, didn't I tell you, if you would believe, you would see the glory of God. God is not glorified in your defeat. God is not glorified in you having all these problems coming up in your life. God is not glorified because things are going on in the house and you ain't glad about it, but you act like you can't do nothing about it. God ain't getting no glory for that. And the devil comes and the devil wants you to think that this is God's will for you to be this, you to have no money, for you to have nothing, no power, for you to have no faith. But you always going to be like this. Had the devil ever came to you and told you that this is all you're going to be? This is all to your life? You're going to always be like this? And some folks, when you try to tell them something, they're trying to bring them out of their problem. They say, leave me alone. I'm all right. I'll go on and live on the minimum wage. I got a job that's going to pay you 6 salaries. I don't want to go over there. Some people might cause me to write evaluations. They might even cause me to be a boss. I'm all right. tonight, sitting in this corner, making the minimum wage. See, but I'm here to tell you, God ain't a God that's just going to sit back and let you just relax in your trouble. He going to rock your boat enough to where he going to put some fire under you. They tell me in the book of Acts that they was all on one accord. They was all comfortable. They were breaking bread. They was taking communion. They was reading the doctrine of the apostles. They were being taught. But God said, look, I want you to be a witness. I want you to go out into all the world. But they was comfortable, just like we get some kind of comfortable just sitting in the church and there are folks out there dying. But we get comfortable. He said, look, I got to raise up a Saul that's going to put some fire under these people. And the Bible says Saul came in there and he stirred things up. The Bible said they went everywhere preaching the gospel, telling everybody about Jesus. Sometimes God got to put a fire under you and stir you up. But the thing is this, Jesus tells them, they just believe, girl. You're going to see the glory of God. And then we're going to just close it out. Look at that 41st verse. He says, then took away the stone from this place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I know that thou hears me always. But because of the peoples which stand by, I say it that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Ain't nothing like a prayer that you know has been heard. Huh? He's speaking of this prayer as a past tense. I've prayed, God have heard my prayers, I know it's been answered. He walking up to a grave, his whole ministry is on the line. He's walking up to a grave to confront death. And I believe death has got his chest poked out. I believe death feel like you ain't gonna get this boy back. And I believe as he walks up there and he faces death, he said, look, move the stone out the way. Get all that unbelief, all that doubt out the way. Open it up. Let God in. Let him step into your life. He'll do something you ain't never think could be done. When they move those things out the way, and he prayed. He prayed so that God hears him. He hears prayer. Bible tells us in Mark 11:24. He said, when you pray, believe that you receive, and you shall have the things that you pray for. You will get it. Look at it as I prayed. God have heard my prayer. That's a past tense. Jesus, I know you heard it. I already done prayed for Lazarus to come back to life. I already done prayed for him to get up out of this grave. Already done prayed for death to let him loose. But you know when he came there, everybody was thinking, what is this man gonna do? Is he crazy? Don't he know this man is stinking? Don't he know when you in the grave for 4 days, you can't live again? Don't he know this is ridiculous? But yet, when Jesus walked up to the grave, he prayed. He said, I know you always hear me. You've done heard this prayer. I'm just saying it for the folks around me so that they'll know that you answers prayer and you answered my prayer. And then he looked at the thing that was holding Lazarus and he called him by name. Somebody said if he hadn't called his name, everybody would have got up out that grave and came a walking. But he said, Lazarus, come forth. Just let me know. Death is not as powerful as the word of God. When God speaks, death has to let go. Do you see light coming into darkness and darkness backing up? Because that light overcomes it. That light is more powerful. When he said, Lazarus, come forth. Death, as strong as death is, as bad as death is, Jesus said, death, you got to let him go. And the Bible says he comes out hopping. Come out hopping. It would have been better if he'd have been walking. But he hopping. The Bible said he shouted with a loud voice. I guess them people laughed. They said, oh my goodness. This man done lost his mind. But when they saw Lazarus come a hopping, I bet their tongues fell down, their eyes scratched, their heart went down. They just said, ain't no way. That boy walking, that boy coming out of that grave. But you see, he showed them, I'm life. I give life to whoever I want. I say, you live, you gonna live. I sustain life. I'm the giver, I'm the source of life. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Life is greater than death. That's why God says that we have eternal life. Life is greater than death. So when Lazarus come forth, another revelation appeared. They realized this is God. This is God in the flesh. Because can't nobody give life but God. Huh? And when Lazarus stepped out of that grave, huh? I believe everybody said, look at here, this boy ain't crazy. Huh? He ain't demon possessed. He ain't somebody you want to kick to the curb. I believe a revelation came that said, look, this is somebody you need to believe. This is somebody who pronounced, if you believe, you shall be saved. This is the Son of God. This is God in flesh. Nobody called him crazy after they saw Lazarus. Nobody say it's ridiculous what he's trying to do when they saw Lazarus. When they saw Lazarus, all they could do was just look with an amazement at what God can do. Huh? The revelation of Jesus Christ. He is the resurrection and the life. Is there any here today that needs prayer? God is here to bless you. He's here to restore you. He's here to cure your problems. He's here to make everything all right. Let us all stand for this. Just gonna pray a unison prayer. Oh, yeah. Our prayer warrior here. He got to get anointed and get prayed. Thank you, Jesus, for him. He gave him a pray for him because he prayed this morning in Sunday school, led us in prayer. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Like we're going to get them out of the seats anyhow.